thanks. O incense of forgiveness, we worship you, for you have brought us close to your Father, enriched us by your birth, purified us by your baptism, sanctified us by your crucifixion. Reconciled us to the Father by your resurrection, raised us by your ascension, and adorned us with the gifts of your Spirit. Now, O Lord, accept our incense and fill us always with your sweet fragrance, so that our tongues may never cease in giving thanks to you forever.
Christ has been raised from the dead,
the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a human being, the resurrection of the dead also came through a human being. For just as in Adam all die, so too in Christ all shall be brought to life, but each one in proper order. Christ the first fruits, then at his coming those who belong to Christ. Then comes the end, when he hands over the kingdom to his God and Father, when he has destroyed every sovereignty and every authority and power. For he must reign until he has put all enemies under his feet. The last enemy to be destroyed is death. Praise be to God.
Behold the place where they laid him.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. There is a story told from the 1960s. Everyone knows the name of Thomas Merton, the Cistercian from Gethsemane Abbey. Merton was one of these kind of avant-garde. He was a great thinker, profound soul, beautiful writings. Tormented soul, that's a whole other sermon. But in the 50s and the 60s, he kind of hooked on to the beatniks, and he hooked on to Zen, and he hooked on to Tibetan Buddhism. And in the better sense, he dialogued with them. Some of it was probably confusion for him personally, but again, that's another sermon. But with the brilliance of Thomas Merton's mind, on the good side, he discussed religious notions with these non-Christians. And when it came to the Tibetan Buddhists, it was actually kind of humorous. Because they didn't understand this idea of Jesus rising from the dead. And one of the monks said to them once, "We don't understand this because when our dead rise, we do spells and things to make them lay down again." And because, of course, what the Buddhists were thinking was that our Lord just walked out of the tomb back into the life that he had had before. He rose from the dead. Like Lazarus was brought back from the dead. Lazarus rose from the dead. But Lazarus died again later on, as would have done the young man of Nain, the daughter of Jairus, and these other resurrections that we're told of in the Gospel. And what Merton wound up telling the Tibetan Buddhists at that time, they said, "Oh no, but that's not the idea of the resurrection. The resurrection is the movement of our Lord into the transformation of being into the light and the glory of existence, of this transformation." At that point, the Buddhists then understood what it meant. Because it was not the question of just coming back from the dead. It was the question of a transformation of existence to a life of glory. Now, that didn't make them Christians. But at least they understood why this was central to the Christian religion. And I give the example because there's far too many, even among Christians, who think of the resurrection as Jesus just walked out of the tomb, and now he's alive again, and one day he sails off to the heavens. That's the ascension. And this is weird, to say the least. What our Lord does is a return that this new moment that takes place on this day 2,000 years ago is an entire new creation which begins. That the paradise which God established in the beginning, which was order and harmony and beauty and justice and grace, that when the human race decided that that was insufficient, we can do it better, that sin of our origin, which affects all of us individually to this day, of course, was a screw-up. They didn't make the order of beauty and grace and harmony that was originally created better. We just have to look around us to know that the world is not in that beautiful order. So that what we're doing here on this day, when all these women that come, why don't I encourage you, as I always do, read the scriptures this week. Go back and read the ends of the Gospels. It's easy to find them. Just go to the end of it. It's the end of the story. And when you read it, each of the four Gospels are profoundly different. Because what is taking place is our Lord's manifestation, his resurrection. He is physical. When he first appears to the apostles, they think he's a ghost. So they say, "Well, give me something to eat. I will eat with you, and you'll see I'm flesh and blood." And yet it's flesh and blood which is profoundly transformed. Our Lord passes through closed doors. And as you read the Gospels, you'll see this kind of confusion of the stories. Because our Lord is here in the garden, and then he's here in Emmaus a few miles away. Then he's in Galilee, then he's back in Jerusalem, then he's in Jerusalem in the evening. He's here and here and here and here. And the Gospels record these stories of our Lord appearing to different people. Because whereas our Lord is physical, he is in his human nature, resurrected from the dead, it is a human nature which has been renewed and transformed. What we celebrate on the resurrection is a new creation. This is a cosmic event which takes place of God incarnate, to which we are invited to enter by faith and by baptism. And that grace that transforms us is precisely what we see here and there. When our Lord meets the first women, they find nothing in the tomb. They leave, they go away. Then our Lord appears to them. They fall on the ground. They're overwhelmed by seeing him. And they do what you'd expect them to do. They fall on the ground. They grab around his knees and hug him. But our Lord is trying to elevate them to understand that what has happened is not just that he's back. This is a transformation of something very profound. Of the entire human race, in principle, in its origin, in the reason why our Lord is called the new Adam. As the old Adam was the origin of all of the human race that descends from him, and we know this even by the science of genetics, that there is one man and one woman. The same reason our Lord then, in the transformation of his human nature on this day, he becomes the fountainhead and the source of an entirely new created human race. When St. Paul writes about the human race on earth, he breaks them into three races, in fact. The people of Israel, because of the law on Mount Sinai. The pagans, who only have the law of nature, do the best they can with their wits. And that third race, which is Christians. He breaks humanity up into these three. But of course, for St. Paul, as he reminds us that the Christianity is meant to spread to the entire human race and encompass it in this new creation. So when these women come to the tomb, and we're told in this gospel today that you have in your bulletin, that when they leave, they're trembling. They come to find a body to finish doing the devotion of burying our Lord. And not only do they not find the body, they find this enormous stone that's taller than a man that's been rolled back. And then they find somebody in there. And who points out, telling them that now he's risen from the dead. And when they leave, the English translation that we have, we're told, is that they tremble and their fear seizes them. In the Greek of the Gospel, the term that's literally there is ekstasis, our word ecstasy, but not in this kind of vulgar sense that we have today in English. Ekstasis literally means, stasis is to stand. Ek in Greek is outside. Ekstasis literally means that they are standing outside of themselves. They are overwhelmed by what has taken place at this dawn. When our Lord appears to Mary Magdalene, and as you read the Gospels, they will tell you, she thinks he's the gardener. St. Ephrem will spin an entire series of poems around this idea of our Lord being the gardener, because in fact, through this new creation, he is the new gardener. He reestablishes a paradox through this new creation to introduce this renewed humanity. Which is why, when he appears to Mary Magdalene, she doesn't recognize him as a city. She thinks he's a gardener, and when she recognizes him finally and falls down to do the same thing that the other women had done, to grab him around the knees in this act of love, he pushes her back. Pushes her back because there is something more that he wants her to learn. The other women he allows. Mary Magdalene is to be taken further in the understanding of grace and this new creation. So what I want to leave you with is that every morning in Safra, our morning office, we address our Lord as the radiant day, capital R, capital D, the radiant day and the source of all light. This finds its origin, this title of the radiant day, in this new creation which takes place. That when you read the gospel again that you have in the bulletin, it has a phrase that says, on the first day of the week, that's when the women go out. But that's not actually what the gospel says in itself. It talks about on the first of the Sabbath. This is the term which is actually there. Be'ehad ba'shabbaton. Shabbaton is the term which is used literally from Sabbath, referring to the entire week. Echad just means one. So that when the gospel is being written in Greek, it uses the term mia, the first. It doesn't say first day. On the one of the rest of Sabbath, these women go at dawn, the rising of the sun, to this tomb. Now, none of this may make any big difference to any of you. But the reason why I bring it up is what the gospel is pointing out is that this is the beginning of something new. Be'ehad. This is a first rising of the sun. This is a new, which is why next Sunday we call New Sunday. And we'll develop this idea of why we call the octave day of Easter a New Sunday. But it's already contained in this gospel of the firsts in the Sabbath, which is literally the term being translated into Greek. But this is an entire new creation following the rest, Shabbat, of the old creation. All of that in the period of forwards. I have great faith that you have profound minds and are able to bring all of this in. So we leave you, I will wave my arms around for the end of the sermon because it makes it easier. What we wind up seeing here then is that what takes place in the work of redemption is that God, the eternal hidden one, Alohogenizo, the hidden God, appears in time born in Bethlehem to Mary of Nazareth. We all like Christmas. Everyone likes a baby. But it's not about the baby. It's about the manifestation of the hidden one in time and place. And that as he embraces this human nature and lives through his life of Nazareth and then teaches for 3 years, he embraces all of that failure, shortcomings, illness, everything else that comes by that bad choice of our original parents in paradise. He embraces all, including the significant sign of death. He embraces death willfully. It is not due to him, he is sinless. But he embraces death and he marches towards Jerusalem. And he allows this arrest, this humiliation, this betrayal by Judas and the others. And his crucifixion and death, which is why at the moment of death he says, it is all consummated, it is finished. He embraces death. Death and that human nature being consumed by death. Death itself is consumed by our Lord's divinity. He enters into the place of the dead. That's Friday night and Saturday. It's what we say in the creed. We believe in the descent into hell. That's a whole other sermon. And that when our Lord rises in a new creation, he has destroyed death, recreated human nature in this new creation, so that in that glory of physicality but of transformation, he invites each of us individually to enter into this sublime light, a radiant day and source of all light. This is the gift being offered to us. So enjoy your peeps this afternoon. Have fun with your egg fight. But remember that what we celebrate profoundly here is that each one of us personally has been and is invited through faith, grace, baptism, not just simply to believe, but to be transformed anew into that transformation of light, which is not something that happens later on. It begins here, now, today, this transformation. And it's because the transformation begins here that when we die, death has been changed not from something permanent, but to a mere transit point to the kingdom of light in eternity. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, amen.
Thank you. Rise you to his word. Mary wiped away your tears. Christ the Lord rose. Truly rose. Tears and sadness passed away. Joy and gladness now prevail. Mary wiped away your tears. Christ the Lord rose. Truly rose. A sweet fragrance fills the earth. Christ the Lord lives. Mary, wipe away your tears. Christ the Lord rose, truly rose. Peter and John at the tomb saw the Lord's shroud and believed. Mary, wipe away your tears. Christ the Lord rose, truly rose. Here, O death, where is your sting? Where thou crown lost the fight. Mary, wipe away your tears. Christ the Lord rose, truly rose. Lord, your rising shows itself like a bright light on a hill. Mary, wipe away your tears. Christ the Lord rose, truly rose. Come, O Thomas, touch my wounds. Truly I rose from the tomb. Mary, wipe away your tears. Christ the Lord rose, truly rose.
Strengthen you in faith, for you truly love your God. You truly
Even his life has again come to life. Still in the cross, he returns from the dead. He released those held captive there and destroyed death forevermore. So we sing and rejoice. Christ has saved all the world. Christ rose from death, clothed in glory and might. He slept in death and gave hope to the dead. He destroyed death and its domain, then awoke in great majesty. He was free from all pain, and in triumph was glorious.
Our Lord Jesus
Christ, truly risen from the dead, grant and pardon to all souls. In the joyful faith we sing to him. Blessed are you, Lord. You have saved us by your cross. Oh, holy are you, Jesus. Holy are you. We glorify you, Christ our King. His mother Mary, we commemorate this day, and we sing with her our praise. We remember all the holy ones, the saints of God, and those who have died in faith. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
Rejoice, Queen of Heaven, sing with joy. O rejoice, Mary, on this day. Christ, your Son, is risen, truly risen from the dead. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. O rejoice, O Queen of Heaven, sing with joy. O rejoice, Mary, on this day. Christ, your Son, is risen, truly risen from the dead. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. Alleluia, 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 alleluia. We will continue on page 748 with the creed. We believe in one God,
Father, Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, all things is Lord. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, born of the Father before all ages, God from God, light from light, pure God from pure God, begotten, not made, consubstantial with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, and by the Holy Spirit was incarnate of the Virgin Mary, and became man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried, and rose again on the third day, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended to heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is adored and glorified, who has spoken to the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic Church. We confess one baptism for the forgiveness of sins, and we look forward to the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Thank you.
place of their earthly gifts, grant them life and your kingdom. Especially Mary, the Blessed Mother of God, Saint Joseph, her spouse, Saints Mary, Saint Jude, and Saint Charbel. Remember, O God, the children of the Holy Church, our fathers and mothers, and our brothers and sisters, both the living and the departed. Especially those who are the sacrifices offered for the intentions of all the members of this parish. Remember also all those who share with us today in this offering.
Thank you.
your only sons and your blessings upon those who bow before your holy altar. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
O God, the Father, in your love for all people, you sent your Son into the world to bring the lost sheep back to you. Do not turn your face away from us as we celebrate this spiritual and bloodless sacrifice. Relying on your mercy and through the grace of your only Son, we hope that through this mystery instituted for our salvation, not be for our condemnation. Rather, may you blot out all our sins, forgive our faults, and be an expression of our thanks for your goodness. We glorify and honor you, your only Son, and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Yeah. Lord, have mercy. salvation. Remember those who have presented offerings upon your holy altar, those for whom they have been offered, and those who have desired to make an offering but were unable, those we have remembered and to whom we have not. Reward them with the joy of your salvation and accept their offering upon your heavenly altar. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, our civil leaders and clothe them in your fear, that they may stand for justice and establish peace. Remember also captives and prisoners, the sick, the suffering, and the afflicted, the needy and those who labor in all walks of life. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, all who have pleased you from the beginning, the holy and glorious ever-Virgin Mary, the patriarchs, prophets, and apostles, St. John the Forerunner, St. Stephen the Archdeacon and First Martyr, St. James the Brother of the Lord, St. Joseph, St. Jude, St. Maron, St. Charbel, and all the saints. In your mercy, count us among them in the Church of the Firstborn, who are enrolled in heaven. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, the fathers and teachers who spread the word of truth in your holy church and preached your Son, Jesus Christ, to all nations. Through their prayers, send peace to your church and confirm their teaching in our souls. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O God, of all spiritual and earthly beings, the faithful departed who have died in the true faith. Grant them rest and do not take their faults into account. Through our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope that by mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs. Souls, we may call upon you, O Holy Father, that we do not have the strength to endure. But when we are tempted, deliver us through Jesus Christ our Lord. We glorify and honor you, your only Son and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
Peace be with you.
And with your spirit.
Bow your heads before the God of mercy, before his forgiving altar, and before the body and blood of our Savior, whose life to those who partake of him, and receive the blessing from the Lord.
O Lord, we bow our heads before you, awaiting your abundant mercy. Send your blessings upon us and sanctify us, so that we may become worthy to share in your holy mysteries. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and his mercy and love for all people, you are blessed and glorified with him and your Holy Spirit, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of the most holy Trinity, eternal and consubstantial, be with you, my brothers and sisters, forever.
And with your spirit.
Let each one of us look to God with reverence and humility and ask him for mercy and compassion.
Holy gifts for the holy, with pure in perfection, purity, and sanctity.
One Holy Father, one Holy Son, one Holy Spirit, blessed be the name of the Lord, for he is one in heaven and on earth, to him be glory forever. Make us worthy, O Lord God, so that our bodies may be sanctified by your holy blood, and our souls purified by your forgiving blood. May our communion be for the forgiveness of our sins and for new life. O Lord our God, to you be glory.
Again and again we thank you, O Lord, and praise glory to you for giving us your body to eat and your living blood to drink. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Have mercy on us, O Lord, O compassionate and merciful one. O lover of all people, have mercy on us.
Syriac, Mishio Kom Min Kavaro, Shavuot Kol. Christ is risen.
He's truly
Christ
risen.
Is truly risen. Christ is risen.
Christ is truly risen.
You don't sound like Easterners. Christ is risen.
Christ is truly risen.
Christ is risen.
Christ is truly risen.
Christ is risen from the dead.
Christ is truly risen from the dead.
Go in peace, my beloved brothers and sisters, with the nourishment and blessings you have received from the forgiving altar of the Lord. May the blessing of the Most Holy Trinity accompany you, the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the one God, to whom be glory forever.
Amen.